Today is going to be a little bit of a different video. I'm going to be talking about how exactly I organize my day inside ClickUp. We're going to be touching on things like everything view versus home, organizing and triaging what tasks you're going to be focusing on, how to handle notifications, and our way of organizing our projects for each quarter. So if you're someone who is trying to, you know, adopt ClickUp and you're trying to figure out what life will look like for you after that or some other systems you might be implementing, definitely watch this video to get a sense of what the after is, because I will tell you, the way we work right now is night and day from what it was a year ago. And I want to share with you guys what exactly I'm doing to make it feel so much calmer. All right, so with that, let's dive in. So once I get the coffee brewing and I'm ready to start up my workday, I am heading into the office. And as you can see, this is kind of my office here. I usually start my day around 6:30 or so. I'm usually at work about 7:30. I don't really do too much else in the morning because I'd rather just get right to it with maximum energy. If you guys would like to see a different video talking all about the gear I use, feel free to let me know in the comments. All right, so once I'm ready to finally start my day, my journey usually begins inside of Google Calendar. So looks something like this. This is my Google Calendar, nothing radical here. I usually am checking this on my phone when I first get up or before I go to bed the night before, just to check in on my commitments to others. Any event, meeting, even like with my husband who works with us, everything like that ends up on the Google Calendar so I can keep track of what I've committed to other people so I can know how to kind of manage my energy, I guess, for the day. When I'm actually starting my day in Google Calendar, if there's nothing going on, like I don't have any meetings going on right there, my next spot to go into would be ClickUp. And as you can see, my ClickUp defaults to notifications because that's typically the first place I check. When it comes to notifications for me, I am checking for emergencies. So this first pass through notifications for the day, I'm just checking to see, you know, is anything a big hot button issue that I need to handle, anything I need to stop everything to go do. Occasionally we will have some kind of major issue like our website is down or this, that, and the other that does require me to change my plans. But for the most part, this is just a quick skim to see what I have on my plate. At this point, if any of these notifications are irrelevant, I'm just gonna check them off and get them off my plate. I've already done that by this point, so I'm down to the three notifications that I've really want to take some time to address later on today. From notifications, assuming there's no, you know, emergency topics, my next spot would be to go to my everything view. Well, let me just show you. Here is my tasks. This is just a view that we created and named for the whole team here. This is the default for everyone, pinned to the front, default to me mode. Those are the settings here. Basically, it just shows every single subtask or task separately, filtered to only show stuff assigned to me, and grouping everything by due date. So in many ways, this ends up being a lot like the home view, but it's just a little bit more customizable, and I just find it a little bit more helpful. So that is what we've got going on here. So I can see here I've got two overdue tasks and nothing due today, which makes sense. I'm caught up, but I'm trying to clean up some of the stuff in the past, which is why I haven't committed to anything today. I see the two tasks on here. By the locations, I know what kind of tasks they are. I see one issue task and one routine task. And let me actually talk a little bit about that, because that's kind of the next step in this daily triage. Once I start my day, figure out what tasks I have on my plate, I've already considered what notifications I have, it's time to start actually getting some work done, assuming I don't have any meetings. When it comes to getting work done, the balance between doing notifications or doing tasks assigned to myself, it gets a little bit blurry. There are times where I will go right into notifications and get those cleared out because I know people are waiting on me to get their work done. If none of the notifications are time-sensitive issues, I'm just going to leave them there and focus on my own tasks first. That allows me to avoid getting stuck in the weeds. So usually at this point in the day, I'm going to start a timer of some kind. I usually don't give myself a timer for those initial, like, getting my day started tasks. But once I'm getting ready to do some work, I want to get a sense of what I'm doing and how much of it. This has been something that, again, has been hard to stick to. It's something that I used to just do for like 2 weeks at a time and use that as some sample data to extrapolate forward. But as we're doing more hiring, and I really want to be sensitive to the time cost I'm putting into things lately. So I'm trying to be more meticulous about tracking time in general, always. So before I start any work here, I'm going to actually click on the task itself and start a timer so I can time myself to know how long that task is taking me. I'm not billing for this time because of my structure, but I do want to know how much my time cost is when it comes to these projects. So I could go in here and I could just track time on the task. I could open the task and then track time. Or I could actually use my miscellaneous task categories, which, if you're not familiar with that idea, you might like this video up here that explains it. But basically, we have this also a favorited area called miscellaneous time tracking, where I have a bunch of general time categories that I use for all sorts of things that don't really fit into tasks. So for example, I'm not going to create a task that's every day telling me to check Slack. I'm going to just check Slack. I just know how to do that. But I still want to capture that time because 5-10 minutes here or there, that's a lot of time over a year. So that's where this comes in. You can see things like clicking up our main membership. I've got some main categories that go into this, and I can just quickly click the start timer button to start the countdown on any of them. Right now you can see I have the YouTube content timer running, so I'm not going to click anything here because I'm not actually doing anything but YouTube content. Once my time is being tracked, either on one of these general categories or if possible, on the task itself, I can actually start doing the work. So that might look like, you know, whatever it is the task is. So we kind of use a combination of locations and due dates to determine priority in ProcessDriven. So I have all these tasks due, and obviously I have them grouped by due date, but I have two things here due on the same day, and it can be kind of hard to know which is the top priority. The way we have our tasks organized right now is all inside one folder that we call our capacity defense area. The layout I'm about to show you here is actually not one that we've yet published in the course because, well, honestly, I've been testing it. So just know that this layout is going to be a little different just because we're experimenting with some stuff. Now, how we're organizing our capacity defense in this action tasks area is into four sections with a backlog. So the top section of this is our issue tasks. The issue tasks area, the number one slot, is for emergencies. It's for something that's a one-off thing that we've committed to that we just have to get done. There's no negotiation on it. It needs to get done. That is going in the issues area for us. That could be any kind of small thing like, oh, update the website link that's broken. It could be a huge thing like the website's down. Any kind of emergency that's a non-negotiable because we've either committed to it in a very public way or it's a big problem goes into that issues area. I put a number one in front of the issues area just to designate that this is always going to be our top priority when we're trying to decide what to do next. From there, we have the routines list, and this is the second list because it is the second priority. Routines contain all of our routine tasks, tasks that need to be done, and they're non-negotiable because they're on an ongoing basis. They always need to be done. As we move down kind of the hierarchy of the business, which we're super small, so the hierarchy is tiny, but as we move down that leadership rung, we see more and more routines be part of someone's day-to-day work. And honestly, the whole business is becoming more and more routine as we figure our stuff out and find our footing. One of my goals as a business owner is to make sure that I am not in any of the routine tasks eventually. I'm working on that right now, slowly working my way down to not having routines. But that's what I want to work towards. So I'm always 100% focused on growth tasks or content tasks and not in this routines area. But this would be the second place folks head. So once they handle all the emergencies in the issues area, it's focused on their routine commitments, doing the bookkeeping, running payroll. Those are all routines that are non-negotiable. And that's what the second area is all about. Next up, we have the growth list, and this is number three. The growth list is all about the tasks that move us forward. For those of you in clicking up, this is the tasks plan for this period. This is the same thing. What this is all about is we always try to find one or two things max to really focus on making better over a period of time. And we choose to choose a period of 90 days. So we have 90-day projects, and those are our top priorities. So to make those priorities happen, we have tasks associated with them to make them into reality. This isn't a novel concept. So this would be the next place someone would look if they're trying to figure out what to do. The third tier would be to work on those growth tasks. As you can see here, the growth tasks consist of tasks which are blocking relevant projects. So let me actually go into one of these. One of our current projects right now is to upgrade our major systems. And here's the actual project task. And here are all of the things that have to happen in order for that project to come to fruition. If I go to the growth projects list where the overall projects are organized, you can kind of see that we have two major projects right now and four more planned for the future. And that's kind of how we focus our priority. We've got those two top priority growth projects happening, and we have those tasks related to them. So that is what the growth tasks are. These are just any tasks that are related to the core projects for the period. They're not extra. They are moving us forward based on the priorities that we have. The fourth section is backfill tasks. And this is a section that we've actually just started experimenting with because of some requests from our newer team members. As we're onboarding new people, or as we're growing, there is a management burden of having a small team. Like, you have to manage people. That is a full-time job in and of itself. And one thing that we found is really helpful is to have roles, especially the lower tier roles, have backfill tasks. And by backfill, we mean if you have nothing else to do and you don't want to bug me and ask for more things to do, you can always work on this and know that this is a good use of your time. And that this is backfill. So backfill might be, you know, it's the stuff that's low value, but it does need to get done. If you're looking at that Eisenhower matrix, it kind of falls into that category. And the backfill area is really built for those people, the folks that are not quite at the leadership level where they always have something they can do, the folks that are more task driven but need that backlog in case the tasks are not quite as predictable one week to the next. So looking at what we have in here right now, the biggest backfill task, which is kind of all of these subtasks here, is just reformatting some old blog posts. Similarly, we have some tasks about giving feedback on our own course, taking the course a few times over. That's a good backfill task if someone has time. It doubles as training, but also gives us some meaningful feedback for our own content. Finally, we have the ideas and backlog list. This is where, and I've made so many videos about this ideas list, so this is basically where we actually keep track of the ideas we have for moving the business forward. These are the things that become candidates for major projects. These are things that become issue tasks or routine tasks. This is where everything starts, unless it's a bona fide emergency or something that we just decide to pull the trigger on really quickly. For the most part, everything goes here first and gets kind of evaluated and combed through on a monthly and quarterly basis to figure out where do we want to go next. So long story short, when someone's trying to figure out how to spend their day and they're in there in everything and they're like, oh, what should I work on first? That number is their cue. So I would start with this issue task first and then bump on to the routine task area. Once I finish the overdue task and the task due today, once that happens, I have the choice. I could either go ahead and work on the task due in the future, which is something I'll often do if I'm feeling kind of overwhelmed. I'll try to work ahead, or I'll start shopping for tasks, which, as I talked about in this video about personal productivity, is something I'm trying to do less of. Now, there is so much more I feel like I could put into this video, so much more I could explain about how we work, how we operate, the ways that ClickUp comes into handy. Like, for example, when it comes to actually doing a lot of these tasks, when I'm creating tasks, I am living so much in the action tasks area, but also our toolbox. So you've seen me mention this on other videos. This kind of view that you're seeing here is part of the proprietary ClickUp template that we have as part of our ClickUp membership. So Process HQ and the way of organizing all your SOPs and automation docs and tasks all in one cohesive system is part of what we include in the membership. But I will say, for the most part, I am living through my favorites here of the notifications, time tracking, and my tasks. I also have some other views that help me focus on other people's stuff. And a lot of forms that we use for collecting ideas or notes or sending things to other people to ensure that they are consistent in format. And of course, I am spending a lot of time in the SOPs area. But again, I don't think I have time to include all of that in this video. Otherwise, this will be like 2 hours long. So because this is something I would love to do more videos about, but I'm not sure if it's interesting to you. Two of the ideas I'm actually considering in terms of expanding this kind of behind the scenes series, if you would be interested, is to actually bring on a member of my team or maybe a few people and have them come on and speak to what it's like to work at ProcessDriven, not to like be like, oh, we're so systematic, because we're not perfect. We're certainly not. But to gather kind of how our daily flow is, because it's very different than any other company I've ever worked for. And from what I can gather, the team has ever been a part of, because we are very, very systematic and SOP driven. And I like to think it's like calm, but we'll see. We could have them on. If you guys would be interested in that, let me know. Interested in meeting team Process Driven, hearing a little bit about what's it like for them to go through their morning routine, go ahead and write team PD in the comments below. The second idea I had a little bit of thought around was to talk about how I'm hiring. So I'm doing a lot of hiring now, really fascinated with HR processes, and talking about how I define roles in my business, because that has been a real game changer for me to figure out how to define what is someone in charge of, how do we hire that person, and how do we communicate to them what processes they need to take over. Because as you might imagine, even when it comes to hiring people, everything is based around processes. And that really takes form in the action area that I showed you. If it was routines, those growth tasks, those backfill tasks, those things all connect, and I'd be happy to dig into that a little bit further if you guys would be interested. And if you'd be interested more in the HR side of things, of how we're defining the actual roles that people go through in ClickUp, go ahead and write roles in the comments below, and that'll let me know which video to focus on next. Or of course, you know, write your own question, and I'd be happy to kind of dive into any of this deeper, because I feel like I just scratched the surface here. But anyway, I hope this was a helpful video, even though it was a bit of a strange one. If you have any questions of your own, feel free to leave them in the comments. And while you're down there, please like and subscribe to help this video reach more people in the algorithm.
Feed that algorithm.
Thank you guys so much for joining me. Until next time, enjoy the process.